those who are absent will be taken care of and corrected, and I pray that those who are sick will be helped and guided by thy wisdom. We'll give thee praise and glory, for we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
266.
266. Okay, standing on the promises.
Uh-oh, something, I got the wrong key.
Oh,
I guess you got it on the big screen there. And I'll go a little bit and then I'll stop and make a couple comments. Okay, God, please bless the reading of thy word, study of your word to our use. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And I stood upon the sand of the sea, this is the Apostle John talking, and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon his horns ten crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. Now, you'll remember last week, we was talking about chapter 12. It was talking about a beast coming up out of the sea. That beast had seven heads and ten horns and no crowns. This beast has seven heads, ten horns, and ten crowns. This is not the same beast as the beast in chapter 12. The beast in chapter 12 was Satan. And the beast here in chapter 13, verses 1 and 2, is the Antichrist. And the description of this Antichrist right here, this beast here in Revelation 13, 1 and 2, is completely similar to the one in Daniel chapter 7. And in Daniel chapter 7, it talks about it says that the beast came up out of the sea, and he had, like he was likened unto a leopard, a lion, and a bear, but he was a dragon too. And but in Daniel, it doesn't call him a dragon. It's like a nondescript thing as far as that fourth beast goes. But then here, he comes right out and calls him a beast. He says, and the beast which I saw was likened unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth is the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority. And I saw one of his heads, as it were, wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast. Now, you know, it says one of his heads was wounded. In chapter 12, we saw that the seven heads, the seven kings of Revelation 12, was seven Gentile governments that came from Noah. Okay, it started with Nimrod, went to Sennacherib, Nebuchadnezzar, Darius, the king of the Medes, Alexander the Great, and Rome. That's seven. And then it says one of his heads was wounded. Well, one of those heads was the last one of those seven. It was Rome. Now, Rome was wounded, but it was never killed. It was never cut off completely. All it did was go into a mystery religion, kept control of politics and all the governments that it could of the world at that time, and up until now, it's still in that mystery religion form. But now, the Antichrist is about to come. And he's going to take on, it says, we'll get to that, it says, and they worshiped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast, who is able to make war with him? By the way, the word worshiped means kiss. They're actually, during the tribulation, going to kiss the devil, if you can imagine that. They're going to worship the devil, which means they're somehow going to be kissing the devil. And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue 42 months, that's 3.5 years. And he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle, and them that dwell in heaven. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them, and power was given unto him over all the kindreds and tongues and nations, and all that dwell upon the earth that worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life, and of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. And if any man have an ear to hear, let him hear. And he that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints. Now, during the tribulation period, people were not sealed into the body of Christ. And you're going to have people, the Bible talks about those that persevere to the end. That means those that resist getting the mark of the beast. And during the middle of the tribulation, when the devil goes into the sanctuary, he's going to sit on the mercy seat, the Holy of Holies, and Israel's going to flee to the wilderness. God's going to help him. It says, give him two great wings to flee to the wilderness. For 3.5 years, God is miraculously going to feed Israel out in the wilderness like he did when they first brought him out of Egypt. Because they're not going to be able to buy, sell, or anything unless they got the mark. And they're not going to take that mark. And the devil's going to be roaring and everything else. But I want to make some notes right here. This man will be a satanic trinity. And if you look in Numbers 22:41, you'll see the satanic trinity in the Old Testament. Numbers chapter 22, verse 21. I'll give you a second to get to it. Numbers 22, what did I say? Numbers
22:21.
Yeah, 22:21. Numbers 22:21, it says, and Balaam rose up in the morning and saddled his ass and went with the princes of Moab. And let's see, maybe it was 41. Okay, and it came to pass on the morrow that Balak took Balaam and brought him up into the high places of Baal. Now when it says, and it came to pass on the morning that Balak was the king who symbolized the Antichrist, took Balaam symbolizes the false prophet, and brought him up into the high places of Baal. Baal represented Satan, represented the god Satan. So you got the Antichrist, the false prophet, and Satan, the unholy trinity, right here in the Old Testament, represented by these three men in Numbers 21:41. And then the beast comes out of the sea as a man, Revelation 13:18, who is represented as a leopard, who has the feet of a bear and the mouth of a lion, connected with 10 kings or kingdoms. The reason you have 10 kings or kingdoms in Revelation 13:1-2, but you only have 7 in Revelation 12, is because these other three kingdoms didn't exist at that time. And the wound that was given to that to one of the heads of the dragon, which was one of those 7 governments that we mentioned before, was the wound that was given to Rome when it was overrun by the heathen in around 100 to 200 AD, when the Visigoths and the Gauls and all them, they stormed Rome and Rome fell and everything. But Rome was never done away with. It just changed its form. So it was wounded, but it was not killed. And then it's rising again in the last days with the Antichrist, the beast, being in charge of it and everything. And this was the wound to one of the heads that it's talking about right there. It was the 7th head of Revelation 12, the dragon of Revelation 12. But now there's 3 more. There's 3 more here. And one is likened unto a leopard, one is likened unto a lion, and one is likened unto a bear. Well, that lion, some Bible scholars believe, represents Great Britain. It represents that in the last days, English will be the universal language of the world. And the leopard represents the United States. It's an integrated, like the leopard, it's integrated. You know, it's got a yellowish-brown type of Asian, you know, represents the Asian. It's got the black spots, which represents the Hamites. And it's got a white underbelly, which represents the white race. And then you got the feet like a bear, which represents Russia. So the Antichrist is going to be over, you know, the 7 it's going to be over the 7 kings of Revelation 12, plus adding 3 more, Great Britain, Russia, and the United States, in with it, the 3 that, you know, he's going to be over in the last days. And when he comes up this time, he's going to come like the devil incarnate. You know, he's going to come down, he's in the middle of the trib, he's going to come down from heaven into the sea, you know. Then he's going to come up out of the sea, you know, with representing this 10 nation confederation. And he's going to merge with the Antichrist, who I believe is going to be Judas Iscariot. He's going to come up from the bottomless pit. He's also known as Abaddon or Apollyon. And the reason I say I believe the Antichrist is Judas Iscariot is because Jesus said, I've chosen you 12, and one of you is a devil, not has the devil or is demon possessed. And the Apostle Paul said that the Antichrist, the son of perdition is the Antichrist, and Jesus said, I've lost none of you except for the son of perdition. And so And then in Revelation 17, it mentions that the Antichrist was actually living here at one time just like Jesus. And it says something about him, you know, he is, he was, and he will be. And when Judas Iscariot died, well, hung on the tree, it said he went to his own place. And Peter said he went to his own place, and John said where that place was. I think it's Revelation 9:11, but it was the bottomless pit. That's where his place was. That's where he went to. And so I believe the Antichrist is going to be an unholy trinity. I believe he's going to have the body of a pope, the soul of Satan, and the spirit of Judas Iscariot. And we can tell from Scripture certain things about the Antichrist. First of all, his name, Judas Iscariot, abandoned Apollyon. His mark, a black spot. The Bible says, can a leper change his spots? And the Antichrist, that dragon, is likened unto a leopard. A leopard has black spots on it. You know, it looks like a rosetta or a big pair of lips, black lips. And so his mark is going to be a black spot. When you get his mark, it's going to be like a black spot right between your eyes or on your right hand. And his sign is a kiss. It says the whole world's going to worship him. And the Greek word for worship there means kiss. They're actually going to be kissing the devil. And Judas betrayed Christ with a kiss. His religion is going to be Roman Catholic. That's a given. We already know that. His nationality, he's going to be a Hamitic Syrian Jew. See, Judas Iscariot was from Moab, Kiriath of Moab, which means he was a half-breed Syrian Jew. And so that's what the Antichrist is going to be. And his power, he gets it from the devil, and his number is 666. And the Catholic popes used to wear something on their foreheads for many years, Bilia Dii or something like that, but it's, the number of it stood for 666. And they, for many, many years, they wore that on their forehead until men like Spurgeon and Moody and other fundamentalists started telling the whole world that, you know, they're wearing 666 on their foreheads. So all the Roman Catholic cardinals and bishops and everything else told the Pope, get that off your forehead, you know. They don't wear that on their forehead anymore because the world was starting to wake up to all that stuff. And he says, and I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. Okay, this is a false prophet. And he exercises all the power of the first beast before him, and causes the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. And he doeth great wonders, so that he maketh fire come down from heaven on the earth and in the sight of men. You know, the devil can do miracles, phony miracles or whatever. He can even, you know, like if God gives him permission, he can even reproduce counterfeit life. I mean, the devil is, you know, like these fake healers you got today. And even in India, they got people that are supposed to be able to heal and stuff like that. They do that by the power of the devil. Years ago, there was a temple to the goddess Diana, where it was said that 3,000 people went into that temple, and it was said if they sleep in that temple overnight, that they'll come out healed the next morning. Well, basically, that's what the report said happened, but the ones they could track down suffered severe psychotic disturbances. Because what they did, they went to the devil for healing. And whenever you go to the devil's crowd for healing, you open yourself up to demons. That's all there is to it. And that's what people are doing today when they go to these demon-possessed fake healers or faith healers. You know, if these people were phony, if they're demon-possessed, and you go to them and they put their hands on you, you know, you're getting in all kinds of trouble because, you know, they could actually transfer demons into your flesh. The Bible says, in my flesh, even Paul said, in my flesh dwelleth no good thing. And, you know, we need to get our flesh cleansed every day. You know, like Dr. Ruttman said, he looks in the mirror every day and says, I command you evil spirits to come out of that guy. Because he said, you can't go down the street and look at a billboard sign without thinking some bad thought most of the time, you know. And he said, when you do that, you're just opening yourself up to, you know, uncleanness and everything. So, you know, it's like taking a shower every day. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You know, we're saved and we're saved permanently, but we should have a clean fellowship with God. You know, anytime sin gets in there, get it out, you know. And, but then he said, it's like the red dragon. In Revelation 12:3, he has seven heads with seven crowns. He has 10 horns that are crownless. Then Revelation 13:1-2, each horn has a crown. There's seven heads with 10 crowns. And like I said, it's two different beasts, but when the devil comes down, the Antichrist becomes Satan incarnate. Satan enters into the Antichrist, and the Antichrist becomes Satan incarnate, right in the middle of the tribulation period. And then he goes after persecuting the believers there. And these believers aren't born-again Christians, because you don't get born again in the tribulation period. But they, you know, like if 144,000 Jews, 12,000 out of each of the tribes, convert anybody, they have to stay without that mark of the beast. You know, the Bible says persevere to the end. And this is why so many people in this dispensation think you can lose your salvation, because every heresy is a truth taken from one dispensation and put in another dispensation. And you Christians don't have to persevere. Jesus did it all for us. It's a finished work. You know, we're saved and we're going to stay saved. And that don't mean you go out and sin and get away with it, because you get chastised here and you go lose rewards at the judgment seat of Christ. It's not worth it, but you never lose your salvation. But in the tribulation period, they don't get sealed into the body of Christ. So in the tribulation period, you know, they have to, you know, maintain the resisting the mark of the beast, or get beheaded. Or, you know, be one to be the Jews that got out into the wilderness, okay, and get taken care of God out in the wilderness during that time. And I just want to read something to you real quick right here. It says, the man in Revelation 13 is the satanic trinity. As Satan the Father, he is Lucifer, the anointed cherub, who covered the throne, who is fallen and will become incarnate in a pope at Rome. When the dragon comes down to this earth, this man has been the pope at Rome for 3.5 years. Upon his incarnation at Rome, he becomes the devil incarnate, and the spirit of Judas Iscariot comes up from the bottomless pit and enters into this man. His soul is such, and the man is Satan. His spirit is such as Judas Iscariot. His body is the body of a Roman Catholic Holy Father, a black-robed Baal-worshipping worshiper from North Africa in the Phoenician line of demoniac religions. So that's what the Pope's going to be. He's going to have the body of the Antichrist, is going to be the body of the Pope, the soul of Satan, and the spirit of Judas Iscariot. And I'll finish reading right here. And devises and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound by sword and did live. And of course, the Roman Catholic Church has the most images and idols of any religion out there. In fact, over at the YMCA, where I went to the other day, they had 10 Commandments on the wall. It was put there by some Roman Catholic pagans because they completely did away with the thing about having no graven images and just brought up all the other commandments, one, and divided the 10th one in half. So they still wound up with 10 commandments, but they completely did away with the thing that thou shalt not have any graven images, because it hit them right between the eyes. And he had power to give unto the image of the beast. The image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And like I said, God, the devil can get power from God if it's to do judgment on unbelievers and everything, to do, you know, these miracles, to see, because God's going to pour out a strong delusion after the rapture of the church that they'll believe a lie. And this is part of their God's judgment on them, because they rejected Jesus Christ up until that time. And so God's saying, if you don't want Jesus Christ, I'll give you the Antichrist. Give it to you all you want. And he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, so that no man might buy, sell, or sell, save he that has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him that has understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. And like I said, that was the number the popes had on their forehead for generations and generations, until, you know, it was getting obvious, you know, the Bible believing fundamentalists made it obvious to everybody, you know, that they are the 666 beast, you know, representing. And in fact, the King James translators, in their preface, in the King James Bibles, they even identified the Pope as being the Antichrist, that the popes are sitting in the seat of the Antichrist. Even the King James translators knew that. And so that's why when I get King James Bible, I always like to have that preface in the beginning of it. But so, you know, the Antichrist is going to be here soon, but the rapture is going to happen sooner. The worse the world gets outwardly, the closer Jesus gets. And so, I'm like some people say, I'm not looking for the undertaker, I'm looking for the uppertaker.
All right, very good. Thank you.
Let's do a little bit of question and answer then. How many of you know what types and shadows are? You've heard the Bible say that, how many times have you heard people say that there's contradictions in Scripture? One of the things they'll always take to Jesus is the plaque that was put upon the cross. Okay? Because you have the three different Gospels say three different things, but they don't. They all say part of one, and John's got it all in one. Okay? So what happens, you have types and shadows. In other words, the Lord will show you something on a scale, then a larger scale. We talked about that in Revelation 18. Now, when he's referring to, right there in the beginning, where the Antichrist comes out of the waters, he comes out. Waters always represent the Gentile nations. So the Antichrist comes out of the Gentile nations. And the false prophet comes up out of the earth, which is the Jews. So the false prophet is going to appear, appear to be a Jew. Now he may be of the synagogue of Satan, like George Soros. Now, I find it interesting that here you got Barack Obama, okay, and this guy is an Antichrist. I mean, my gosh, he fulfills every single characteristic an attribute you can find in the Bible of the Antichrist. And now you see he's going after North Carolina, saying he's going to, because they stood against that his sodomite bathroom bill. And then the Bible says that the false prophet empowers, the Antichrist gets his power. But George Soros has been funding Obamanation, this man of great, great sin. Now, when he refers to he that was, is not, and will be, the fifth was, he is now, is the time this is writing, is not. In other words, he was alive, but now he's dead. See, now, when you talk about the spirit of, remember what Jesus said when they were talking about Elijah will come, and Jesus said, Elijah came, he didn't recognize him. He wasn't talking about the person in the flesh, the individual, he's talking about the spirit of. And so that same spirit of Nero Caesar, who lit his garden at night by wrapping Christians in their clothing, soaking them with oil and burning them alive to entertain his friends. He was a very extremely wicked person, Nero Caesar. He was, and at the time of this writing, he was not alive, he was dead. And you're going to have, the next would be the seventh, and then the same spirit of Nero Caesar, the same spirit, and the same spirit of Judas will be the eighth, which will be the Antichrist, okay? So we don't know. A lot of people still believe Obama could be the Antichrist, and may be that Antichrist. There's a lot of things going to happen here. Things are moving very quickly. We're deteriorating. On a worldwide scale, the world is getting ready for war. So between now and, you know, in the very near future, I can't see Obama allowing free elections in November. I don't think he's got any plans in allowing free elections. He's moving very, very quickly. I think he's going to try to start civil wars in this country. And I'm not the only one. General Boykin, in fact, a lot of your major military men are very, very concerned about that. Yeah.
Could the leopard be Germany instead of the USA? Russia, Great Britain, and Germany?
The leopard has, you can have more than one application there, okay? I think what you're going to find about the USA, if you turn to Daniel chapter 12, and you read the last part of 11, we'll start actually in Daniel, and maybe we should maybe take a look at that next week. But in Daniel, he starts by describing the Antichrist. Daniel chapter 11. Now, up until verse 36, they're talking about an Antichrist. It was Antiochus Epiphanes, who was the one who offered up the sow in the temple. Okay, desecrated the temple. But now, starting in verse 36, they're talking about the Antichrist, okay? And he tells you some things about him there. He will exalt himself and magnify himself above every god. That word god with a small g means a people of authority. And shall say marvelous things against the God of gods. Marvelous there means things that are not true, okay? And against the real God. He shall prosper and his indignation be accomplished, for that it is determined shall be done. Neither shall he regard the God of his fathers, nor the desire of women. In other words, he's going to be a homosexual. Obama is a flaming homosexual, okay? Remember what Obama said about the Lord Jesus Christ? He said he is a savior, but only one of many. He said he's one of many. Okay, what did he say about the book of Romans? He said the book of Romans is irrelevant. It's meaningless. Okay, it's meaningless is what he said. He said about Leviticus, it was what? Archaic, okay, and of no. So he went after the word of God. Now here's the thing. If you go here and you read, I'll just say it so we can get into the movie. You talk about all the nations of the world, the king of the south. First he goes after the king of the south, which is Egypt and Africa. They go down very quickly. Okay, he's already destroyed Egypt, Obama has. He took out. And then he makes war with the kings of the north and the east. Now, through technology, he defeats the kings. He has a real battle, but it's through technology. America to this day is still, you know, even though they have many, many more boots on the ground than we have hot, much better technology still, okay? But you notice something. So he brings the king of the south, the king of the east, and the king of the north under his subjection. Why? King of the west is not mentioned. It's because the Antichrist leads the west. He leads the armies of the west. And guess who the leader of the west is? It just so happens to be us right now, and at this time, a man of great, great sin, abomination. So, anyhow, with that, we're going to go to this movie. We're going to show 50 minutes of this movie tonight, right up until about 7:30, and we'll take it. And then we're going to show next week the second part of it. And the next week will be the last class for the summer until September. Okay, and then in September we'll be back in our classes. So, now this is a very interesting movie. The second part is actually better than the first part it is. So,
if I can mention something, I don't think it's going to be Germany, because the leopard is an integrated animal, and the Germans aren't integrated. America is known for being integrated. We're the melting pot of the world.
Okay.
And so it fits America to a T. You know, it's yellow, black, and white, you know, Asian, blacks, and Caucasians, you know, we're the melting pot.
Okay, I see.
Yeah. And that was Revelation 17:8. I was looking forward, where it talked about the beast was here, is not coming back, just like it says about Jesus. Only Jesus is coming down, the Antichrist is coming up.
America's quickly going from the melting pot to the bedpan.
Cross the big grave, oh, hard times come again no more.
First, they came for the communists, but I was not a communist, so I did not speak out. Then they came for the socialists and the unions, but I was neither, so I did not speak out. Then they came for the Jews, but I was not a Jew, and so I did nothing. When they came for me, there was no one left. Martin Niemöller, Lutheran pastor, 1939, Nazi Germany. As your first president, I warned you that government was not reason. It is not eloquence. It is force. Like fire, it is a dangerous servant and a fearful master. History now is full circle. You must speak out, or like grass before the scythe, your generation stands witness to the death of a nation. Our revolution now becomes your revolution.
You know, people would never believe me if I told them that world government is not coming, it's here. I have covered 105 global meetings. I've interviewed presidents and prime ministers. I've read tens of thousands of pages of their documents. This is not fiction. This is fact. If you tear down the barriers between the countries of the world, and there is this, I call it mafia, this powerful mafia above the countries of the world, they are coming down through sustainable development in the United Nations and all kinds of control to take the soul of the world.
Behold.
Snowflakes as big as goose feathers, and the moon the color of new-made country butter, and a night sky like diamonds against black velvet reaching from horizon to horizon. I remember Sunday school and kneeling at the cross and trying to imagine what God looked like. Sunday dinner and short pants and haircuts and a little puppy my daddy brought home to me. And I remember love. I remember sitting with my granddaddy on the front porch and watching the last of that magnificent southern sun bleed away into the twilight sky. I remember awesome steam-puffing tin-wheel locomotives and the conductor's watch looked as big as one of my grandmother's biscuits. I remember my mother smiling in her red and white checkered dress. And Christmas always seemed so far away. Yes, I remember you, Carolina, grand old lady of the South. I remember you as home. But today, something's wrong, and we all know it. I'm Charlie Daniels, and I'm here to tell you about it.
It's been my great privilege to serve this nation in the uniform of the U.S. Army. Most of my time in the Army, I spent in special operations. I was one of the original members of the Army's Delta Force. I commanded all the Army's Green Berets. I served a tour at the Central Intelligence Agency, and finished my career as the Deputy Undersecretary of Defense for Intelligence. I was the commander of the Delta Force in the events that we now know as Black Hawk Down. I'm Lieutenant General Jerry Boykin, U.S. Army retired. One of my jobs when I was in the Army was I ran the John F. Kennedy Special Warfare Center and School at Fort Bragg. That's the school that trains all the Army Special Forces. And one of the things that we taught there was insurgency and counterinsurgency. Much of the insurgency was focused on Marxist insurgencies. I see things in America today that just greatly disturb me. And I see a pattern here. And that pattern is a pattern that you see in Marxist movements. And you can see it in Cuba, you can see it in Venezuela, you can see it with Mao Zedong, you can see it with Joseph Stalin.
My name is Elena Kita. I was born in the country of Romania, a country that became communist.
And let me tell you what the things are that I see that are consistent with the pattern that has been seen historically around the world as societies move to Marxism.
in Romania, the changes took place fast and brutal. Changes that tormented hundreds of millions of people.
One of the first things that happens is that the leadership in these countries that moved to Marxism, they nationalize major sectors of the economy.
Since we have been in the United States for 41 years, I have seen changes that are more subtle.
Now in America, that's exactly what we did with the bailouts. We nationalized major sectors of our economy, auto industry, banking.
The government is in nationalization of assets.
Insurance.
That is very inventive.
Gold, then sacks. Remember we bailed out AIG and gave the Goldman Sachs gang $13 billion of our dough to cover their bad debt? When you lose, you lose. The whole nation has changed. The whole game is over. This is not capitalism. Call it what it is, it's fascism.
In the morning, there was a new management. The old management was out. The owner, he was lucky to be in a nice prison cell.
Capitalism, you rise and fall on your own merits. You're not too big to fail.
Oh, but if they failed, you all would die, they told us.
They failed. Do you know what happened if they failed? They wouldn't get their $45 billion worth of bonuses. That's what would happen. Nothing would have happened. Because in capitalism, the slack would have been picked up by those who are doing smart business.
The second thing that they do is they redistribute wealth.
In Romania, a doctor was not paid much more than the checkout clerk at the supermarket.
What we know today as Obamacare was a redistribution of wealth.
When my mother had her heart attack, she was taken to a mental hospital.
I think we've heard a lot about the redistribution of wealth in America.
She died. In a room full of 20 other people. And at my cries, everybody told me, suppress it and leave.
The third thing that you see is you see a discrediting of the opposition.
My father was arrested in 1958.
Because the authorities in power have to discredit those people that would stand up and say, I don't support this.
Attorney could only speak for defense for 5 minutes.
I'm not going to allow this to happen in my country.
The sentence was 10 years in confiscation of all estate. Tortures of the prisoners cannot even be compared with Middle Ages. They came home, if they came home, broken physically, spiritually, mentally. With the same clothes he left from home, all patched up, coming home eagerly to his family.